as Mr. Nick was introducing, my name is Marco Casagrande. I come from Finland, and now we are here together with me some students from Aalto University, which is based in Helsinki, and these students are coming from different backgrounds, and they're part of a research center which is called SGT, Sustainable Global Technologies. And this research center is, you know, Finland is a very, very small country, but it's looking for cases around the world that could be partly financed by United Nations, UN Habitat, to look for a little bit, maybe a bit more far away in the human future and in the development of a built human environment. This case, what we are having here in Taipei, and what we are interested in is, first of all, the coexistence of the urbanized Taipei River Basin, meaning the Taipei City and the Taipei New City, the built human environment, and then the actual river nature. Because as we all understand, Taipei is here because of river. If we think the city development in a couple of simple generations, so the first generation city or first generation Taipei would mean a settlement that has been growing in the Taipei Basin along the rivers, because the environment has provided such conditions that actually a village, and then a bigger than village, something like a city but organic, has been able to be produced. Something, for example, that is impossible where I come from. I come from the very north part of Finland, from Lapland, and the nature is such that actually you must move. You cannot even have a village, you must move. You must be nomad. It's a completely different concept. But in here the nature is so rich and so fast, and it's kind of exploding, that the city could become. And this is the first generation Taipei. And then along with the Japanese, and later on with yourself, the first generation Taipei changed and it became the second generation Taipei, which is more controlled. It's not an organic machine anymore. It's a mechanical reality, industrial machine. And that's when you have urban planning, and eventually after the Second World War, this industrial machine in a way declared, or it did declare, independence from nature. Actually say that the rivers are not needed anymore, or actually the whole natural environment is not needed anymore. On the contrary, it's harmful for the city. And so then you have the industrial machine. And
Mr. Vladimir.
Okay.
Turn by for a few minutes, please.
This is general.
Okay, so now together, like I've been asking the researchers to study the third generation. In my mind, it means breaking the industrial machine or the mechanical reality. What would be the ways that actually the industrial statical machine that is now pouring pollution to nature, and also closing people inside to some fictional surroundings. So how could that be changed or broken or tuned into something which in our minds we call the third generation city, which would be maybe the ruin of an industrial city. And with ruin, I don't mean anything negative, I mean something like something which is man-made but has become part of nature. Now there is a big a struggle with Taipei to keep nature out. Especially the river, you talk about floods and typhoons, and all this is understandable. Still, it's a big push between the industrial man and nature, which is happening in this very small basin. And this is very sexy for us. It's a very good case. And Taipei is, or Taiwan is very advanced in many levels, so we are thinking also that maybe this trouble and problems that we are finding here and dealing with here later on in the next steps, what might happen in, say, mainland China or somewhere else could be used. But Taipei is our case and we are looking for trouble. If we focus a little bit closer to the case, what the researchers are dealing with here now is we are dealing with one special waterway, ancient waterway, that was the source why Taipei could afford to become a bigger village and then a city, and this is the Liaokong Channel. It originates from the Xinbian River, little bit upstream from the Jingmei River, and was done in the 18th century to irrigate the floodplains of Taipei. Irrigate in such a way that the first generation urban man was still farming and dependent on nature, could imitate flooding, like you say rice farming, for example, and use this gravity-based hydrological systems of nature to fertilize and irrigate, fertilize and cultivate Taipei Basin, and succeeded, and so the city started to become. Then step by step on the process, when the first generation city became an industrial city, step by step, as man declared independence from nature, also Liaokong Channel was covered. The built human environment became more asphalt and concrete and bigger also in size, and the decision was that because it was hard to deal with the things that the settlement is pushing out, for example shit, so how to deal with that, so simple solution was to cover the channel, and instead of having running sweet water into the city, they or you change the channel into a sewage. And first it was an organic sewage that it was running into Chilong River, and later on in during the industrial process it became an industrial sewage too. And step by step most of the channel, or let's say more or less all of it, was covered, and the city became. As a final step, as you know, the city built a wall around the city so that you don't see the river anymore, because the industrial sewage was going into the river. Actually it was dangerous for people, not only the flooding but the water itself is more or less poisonous, and it's not like before that you have flooding of 30 centimeters, but you have flooding of 30 centimeter of harmful liquid, something poisonous coming to city, that was closed out. And when the big 12 meter high walls became around the city, that was of course the final cut between the modern, so to say, modern man and nature, and the river environment was closed out from the city's narrative process. And this has been going on for many generations now. Been closed off since 60s. Now we are interrupting this process in a way that we are focusing in a very small part. We are not talking about taking away all the walls at the first step, but we are talking about the possibilities of opening up the Leogong channel. It is still running in three main branches under Taipei City and through different areas, residential areas, commercial and all kind of mixed functions. And what happens if we open it, and what problems do we face when we say that we open it? And then since the researchers come from different backgrounds, including specialists with environmental technology, so actually it is not rocket science, for example, to take the Xindian water and naturally purify it, clean it up, so that it can be used as a clean water in the running stream of a opened up Leogong channel. But if this happens, so what is the accumulating effect for the surrounding Taipei city? This means Taipei goes in a grid like this, and the Leogong channel is an organic three-headed stream in the middle, so a completely new reality would be revealed from under the city. And it would touch all these industrial and modern achievements that you have made. Basically, the researchers not all agree, but in my mind, it means breaking the city. But we have to break the city in a way that it is constructed. The first breaking will be big impact, but then the things that start accumulating for it must be beneficial for the human development and development in a way that this second generation industrial city becomes the third generation city, as which was mentioned as the organic ruin of an industrial city. So what kind of organic tuning can grow from opening up the Leogong channel? And then as Mr. Nick been introducing, he's interested in the aspect of anarchy. And our work is not political, but every public design move and every piece of art is actually political. So whether we want it or not, and in this culture and site-specific conditions, so the introduction of Mr. Nick, anarchy might have some background, since you don't need much of research or studying in Taipei that you find out very strict hierarchies and power controls for the so-called official Taipei. And then again you have the very vibrating and bubbling community activities and individuals, and also economic activities, illegal ones, that is somehow on top of this official, quite rough grid. And the last ones, in at least from in a Western sense, would represent anarchy. And in this one that we are now opening up this channel, we will meet immediately. The first saying will be that it is impossible. And then when you start thinking like why it is impossible, you will meet the power hierarchy from the city government and developers and so forth immediately. But like how we can negotiate this and still keep the process going, what kind of new communities and community activities could be restarted to gain more clean human urban environment. So this is very interesting for us. And this what comes to anarchy, so I will conclude with a very small saying that there is great thinkers from the 19th century like Kropotkin and so, who followed the Marxist theory but didn't go to socialist or the communist ways, but actually set up the footprints of anarchy. But that's very scientific, and it's not part of our work. our, if there is any correlation with anarchy, it means only that anarchy means nature. Nature is anarchy, and always whatever control is imposed, the human nature actually is taken down. Whatever the means to control are. And in our case, we are talking about urban control and opening it up for nature activity. So this conflict of anarchy and control is somehow in the air. Okay, thank you.
You got free beer.